back in Tel Aviv in the 1940s, right, the 1930s, 1940s, I was really fortunate to be in the company of my my high school teacher, even grade school teachers, which were really they came from Germany. They were professors that lost their jobs in Germany, in Heidelberg, and in Berlin, and came over to Tel Aviv to teach high school. They knew that they will never be able to go into a laboratory again, never be able to conduct experiments, never be able to publish a paper anymore. Their life is now constrained by the job they could get in Tel Aviv, and they assumed upon themselves a different mission, to prepare a new generation of a scientist like they would have liked to be, okay, so that the country that they are building would be be a model of excellence. And they were really devoted in that capacity. They spent all the energies preparing our generation, for which I'm grateful, and many of my friends are grateful, because they were great people. They knew, they were polyglots. They knew anything from biology, history, mathematics. And we were fortunate enough to learn science in a chronological progression, which means at any theorems in math that we learn, we learn about the face of an individual, a Greek scientist, a Greek mathematician, who were facing specific problems of the time. The state of knowledge of the time was clarified to us by the teacher. And here is a question that Pythagoras is asking himself. Would the isosceles be describable in some formula in terms of the two sides? Why is it important? Because you have to build a pyramid and you have to find out how many bricks to put on that side and that. Everything was made concrete in a problem-facing situation. And here comes this Pythagoras and invents Pythagoras' theorems. What a joy. What a victory of a human mind over there. That's how we learn theorem by theorem, okay? And we got this joy of discovery by tracing back the steps of these great scientists of the past, all the way from Pythagoras to Einstein.